A few closing comments now on our chapter on the corporate alternative minimum tax and the use of tax credits. Tax credits are quite often a political football in that, now that we know how credits work, the constituents of the Democratic Party tend to favor credits because they'd like to see a tax break available equally to taxpayers regardless of their income level. Whereas by stereotype, Republicans may have constituents in higher tax brackets and want to use deductions and exemptions where the tax break is worth more to them than perhaps to the other side. So as Congress goes Democrat, Republican back and forth, the use of credits and deductions changes with them. And you can see and appreciate now how the politics of this all dictates what our tax system looks like. The overlap between the two topics in this chapter, credits and the AMT, comes about with the philosophy of the AMT, especially for individual taxpayers, as being a flat rate tax with very few deductions and almost no credits. But as more individuals have been subject to the AMT, the pressure has been on and Congress has been giving in to allow more credits and refundable credits against the individual AMT. That same problem doesn't really exist for the corporate AMT because so few corporations pay the AMT and the amount of dollars involved is very small, so that the use of the credit becomes almost a non-issue. There's about 2.5 million C corporations who file 1120s every year, but only about 12,000 of them have an AMT liability. Remember, there's a creation of the minimum tax credit so that they even get that amount back the next year that they become a regular tax taxpayer. The regular corporate income tax collects about $400 billion a year, and in essence, after the minimum tax credit is applied, the corporate AMT collects zero. So there's really not much of an argument to have the AMT at the corporate level, especially because of the two provisions that allow small corporations to relieve themselves of AMT liability altogether. In fact, smaller taxpayers in the corporate form may elect to slow down their regular tax depreciation and amortization deductions just so that for compliance purposes they don't have to keep another set of books to compute the AMT versus regular tax depreciation computations. Think for a minute about your intermediate accounting. When we have an alternative minimum tax liability and a minimum tax credit is created, perhaps to be used in the future against regular tax, that credit is a deferred tax asset. And the question becomes whether we need to set up a valuation allowance to offset it. If we think we're never going to use that credit, we would need to form a valuation allowance and make sure that we release it when it looks like we're going to get out of AMT status and back into regular tax status. So as we go through these tax provisions, don't forget the financial accounting implications of those. And AMT is a really good illustration of how that would work. Thanks for a good chapter on two pretty important topics, tax credits and the corporate AMT.